Until the road gets rough. until the, you know, the narrow road, I don't know who ever painted a picture that it's paved with gold and all downhill. But how many of you know it goes uphill, goes around bends, it goes over mountains? There's hard times sometimes. The Bible teaches us that we will share in Jesus' suffering.
That's right.
So when things get hard, things get difficult, maybe we start to think, maybe I don't want to follow Jesus anymore. Actions define our commitment to Jesus Christ. Words are cheap. But actions speak, how does it go?
Louder
than words. Are you sure? Will you respond? Right now, the words will match up with actions. Are you sure you want to follow Jesus Christ? Hollis, where's he at? Check that. Back to the Word. Please stand out of reverence to God and His Word. Luke chapter 9, verse 57. Here we go. Y'all, stay right here with me. Luke 9, 57. And it came to pass that as they went in the way, a certain man said unto him, Lord, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest. Now we looked at this last week. And Jesus said unto him, foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. And he said unto another, follow me. But he said, Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father. Jesus said unto him, Let the dead bury their dead, but go thou and preach the kingdom of God. And another also said, Lord, I will follow thee, but let me first go bid them farewell, which are at home at my house. And Jesus said unto him, no man, having put his hand to the plow and looketh back, is fit for the kingdom of God. Praise God for his word. Please be seated. Last week we looked at following wherever he leads. Following wherever he leads. And today, follow whatever the situation, or you could say whatever the cause. How many of you, by a show of hands, would consider yourselves followers of Jesus Christ? Look at verse 59 and 60. That's where we're going to land today. That's where we're going to focus. 59 and 60 again. And he said unto another, follow me. But he said, Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father. Jesus saith unto him, let the dead bury their dead, but go thou and preach the kingdom of God. Now the previous man that we looked at last week, he asked to follow Jesus, right? He had asked to follow Jesus. Wherever Jesus would go, he said, I will follow. That will lead, as we said, to the hard places. So if you say that to Jesus, be ready for life at times to get difficult and to get hard. And listen, I know that life gets hard, and I know that there's going to be times when you're going to get into a lull. You're going to cling to doing what the flesh wants to do. But you have to remember, die to self, crucify self, take up your cross, how often? Every day, and follow Jesus. We have to sometimes do things that are good for us that we don't always want to do. Right?
Amen.
And if we always did what the flesh wanted to do, oh my goodness, our lives would be a train wreck. And we've all been there. Amen?
Amen.
In verse 59, Jesus is doing the asking. First man, he asked Jesus. Now Jesus is doing the asking. He has asked many in this room. To you, he says, or has said, follow me. True or false? I'm a faithful follower of Jesus Christ. I'm hearing the mice scatter around here. I'll try again. True or false, I am a faithful follower of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Are you sure? Here we go. You know I'll set this up. Don't you know it? We're going to have to self-examine ourselves as we often do. Let God self-examine us, right? Mm-hmm. Let Jesus evaluate the true or the false, okay? And if I find in my life in these true and false questions that we're about to go through, I didn't like tests in school, but sometimes I know they're beneficial. If we find in this test we're about to go through that there's something that needs to be fixed within us, then by all means, let us fix it. Amen?
Amen.
Here we go. I have zero desire to follow Jesus. True or false? True or false? I follow sometimes. True or false? I follow when I feel like it. True or false? I follow only when it feels good.
False.
True or false? I follow only when I need Him. Oh God, if you get me out of this one, I'll go to church 2 months in a row, but only 2 months. True or false? I pretend to follow to impress other people. True or false? I am a lukewarm follower of Jesus Christ. True or false? I want to follow. I'm just too selfish at times. True or false? I want to follow, but I'm too lazy sometimes. Have you noticed how the answers have kind of went down to a dull roar here? True or false? Other things are more important to me than Jesus. True or false? I'm getting better at following Jesus. True or false? I love Jesus and I love following Him. Amen. And Bill, did you have something? You were going to say something? You're agreeing. True followers follow whatever the cost. Do you agree with that one?
Amen, yes.
When it gets hard to follow Jesus, should we keep on keeping on?
Yes.
Jesus says, follow me. Wait, there is that ugly word, though, in these verses. You know there's an ugly word in there? Look at those verses. The word that spawns excuses. I will follow you, Jesus, but dot, 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 dot.
I do have a question.
Go, Bill.
In one of the songs that the Lord gave me one time when I was having breakfast at my little coffee
shop. Loud.
It says, I started up the road to heaven. Things went smooth for a while. And then the trials and tribulations came and took away my smile. I didn't understand at first. I just didn't have a clue. But it was all part of a wonderful plan that would draw me close to you.
Amen.
Amen.
So the trials we do go through are going to make us stronger.
Amen. Amen. So the trials are for a reason. But when the trials hit, sometimes we start to come up with excuses. I would do this for you, God. I would do this for you, Jesus. But I can't because I've got to do this, that, the other thing. If you put your butt first, it's hard to follow moving backwards. For those that didn't catch that, here it comes again. If you put your butt first, it's hard to follow Jesus when you're moving backwards. I have a poem for you. It's called Excuses, Excuses. Let's get it real quiet and close your eyes for just a minute. It's called Excuses, Excuses. I would follow you, Lord, but please excuse me. Excuses, I've got them on the ready. To tell you why, I won't be there. This to do, that to do, no time to follow you. But don't despair. My words don't match the things I do, but Lord, I care. So hang in there. I will follow through soon. You will see. Excuses, excuses. I've got so, so many. You can open your eyes. I would follow you, Jesus, but I've got important stuff going on right now. I would follow you, Jesus, but I've got a thing I've got to do. I would follow you, Jesus, but my family needs me. I would follow you, Jesus, but I've got a side job. And we could go on all day. Excuses, excuses, excuses. Does God buy excuses? You think we can argue our way to convince him that putting him off is okay? This is not to bring us down. You know, when people hear messages like this, there's one or two things that's going to happen. People will either say, you know what? I need to turn the heat back up and get on fire again for Jesus. And they get more back. They come back to where their first love is.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Or they get offended. And actually, we got a decent crowd for here today, and the pews get empty. And they shoot the messenger. And I'm pretty quick. Well, I used to be anyway. So what are we going to do if we need to tighten up? Some excuses seem important, don't they? Family over Jesus. That seems like the most common excuse I've heard in 17 years of being a pastor. That's probably the most common excuse ever. Family over Jesus. Not everybody can stomach this, by the way. Not everybody wants to put Jesus first. And you'd be better, frankly, to just say that than to pretend. But family over Jesus. That seems to be the excuse that I've heard the most. Should I leave the ministry to go take care of my dad? He's not doing good these days. He's not doing as good as he used to. Should I leave the ministry to go be his caretaker? Though it's been tempting, not according to Jesus, I'm not. Family comes to town. You've seen this one before. Maybe you've done it. Maybe I've done it. Family comes to town for a visit, let's say. And there are some of them are just not churchgoers. Matter of fact, some of them are just downright against going to church. So they make plans at the 11 o'clock hour. And then you have invited them into your home and you have to make a decision. Am I still going to go to church and set an example even though they're not going to go? Which would be the correct answer, following Jesus. Or it's just one Sunday. I'll hang out with them. But you don't realize that when you do that, you also make a statement to them where your priorities are at. I was grateful when Dad came to church. So grateful. But if a family member comes and makes plans, gives reasons not to go, I'm going to church. Because it's hard in this day we live in for people to hear this, but Jesus is supposed to be, since he's God, the Creator. He created all things. He created you. He died for you on a cross, died for me on a cross, rose again on the third day. He is the existence. He's going to be your judge. It seems obvious to me that He should be our priority.
Amen.
All the time.
Amen.
They don't preach this anymore, but Jesus is number one.
Amen.
If I had a foam finger with Jesus' name on it, I'd hold it up there. I'm going to follow Jesus. How about you?
Amen.
Now, careful now. When we say yes, we need to make sure that our actions follow our words, right? Jesus said to the man, back to our passages, follow me. Of course, Jesus already knows what the cost is. But the man said, Lord, suffer me first to go bury my father. Now, without doing some background and some study on this passage, you would come away thinking Jesus is telling this guy, don't go to your dad's funeral. It's not what's going on at all here. Jesus uses extreme examples of an extreme radical faith. Okay? And in the context of what's going on here, I want to read to you a quote from David Guzik, who says it well. Actually, this man did not ask for permission to dig a grave for his deceased father. He wanted to remain in his father's house and care for him until the father died. Then, of course, doing the burial. This was obviously an indefinite period which could drag on and on and on and on. So Jesus is putting this man in a place where he has to make a decision. Family or Jesus? Jesus or family? Commitment to Jesus. Obviously, Jesus was all about funerals, but when he went to Lazarus' funeral, he raised him from the dead, amen?
Amen.
And he made him wait how many days before he showed up? 4 days. You see, Jesus is the God of life, not death. And he's using this example to make a point that we have to be more concerned about people's eternal salvation than what's going on in the here and now. Because this life ain't got nothing for us.
Amen.
Jesus said to the man, follow me. This guy knew following Jesus was good, but his family situation was his priority. At the moment, now we don't know if he said, you know what, you're right, I'm going to follow you. We don't know. Anyone here that's ever put following family above following Jesus? I mean, we probably all don't,
yeah.
But he would want that, right? Jesus would want that. Would he now? Would he now? Actually, he said, radical stuff. And we have to decide if we're going to follow his radical ways. Stuff that defines your true love. And maybe you're listening to this today and it's just clear in your mind that Jesus isn't your priority. And I'm not trying to beat you up. I'm hoping and praying that you can see the value in following Jesus radically every day, making him your number one priority. Because when you do that, he's going to bless you off the chain, bless you.
Amen.
And he's going to be with you through the hard times, through the good times, and he's going to take you to heaven. And
amen.
There, I have not seen and ear hath not heard what he has in store for us. Amen.
Amen.
He wants good for you. The plan is for good. But he wants you to follow him. Make no mistake about it. So, sometimes the choice is there between God and family. And Jesus came hard again. If you'll turn to Matthew 10:34. 35 on down. Read this with me. Matthew 10. Turn there and mark it down. Matthew 10:34. I hear pages turning. Matthew 10:34. Think not that I came to send peace on earth. We sing that every Christmas, don't we?
Yes.
Think not that I came to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword. Why would he say that? Why would Jesus bring the sword? For I am come, by the way, the sword is what?
Word.
The word of God. For I, and he is the word of God, John 1:1. For I come to set a man at variance against his father, and the daughter against her mother, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Why would he do that? And a man's foes shall be they of his own household. He that loveth father, watch this now, because here comes the explanation. Remember, Jesus gave you your family, by the way.
Amen.
He created your children, by the way. He's the one that blessed you, by the way. So where should our love priority be? Verse 37. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Man. I mean, he just does not hold back, does he? This ain't the preacher. This is the preacher. This is Jesus. And he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Now here, we're really getting down to the nitty gritty, because I love that baby that's sleeping on her dad while he's preaching right there. But I know who gave me that child.
Amen.
And I love Jesus more than my family.
Amen.
And he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. This is God we're talking about. The Son of God, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the ending. The everlasting God, Jehovah God.
Amen.
El Shaddai, Jehovah, all the names, that he's called. This is the Creator, the Word of God. I started to go down the list of them. But let me get back here. Verse 39. He that findeth his life shall lose it. And he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it. I'll follow you, Jesus, but not yet. I got a thing to do. I got to take care of my dad, the man was saying. So, you do understand, right, Jesus? Jesus was making it abundantly clear who our priorities should be in this life.
Yeah.
Because we're going to stand before him one way or another. And then we're going to kneel one way or another. I choose to kneel now before the Lord and Savior
Amen.
Jesus.
Amen.
And I'll do it then. And I'll do it throughout eternity. And I'll worship him throughout eternity. Jesus knew this life ends in death. The wages of sin is death. The kingdom of God preached is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Jesus said unto him, let the dead bury their dead, but go thou and preach the kingdom of God. Following Jesus, whatever the cost, Jesus was shooting straight. He knew he would lose many. I have grieved. I mean grieved over people that have come through these doors and sometimes spent years and then leave. Sometimes God moves them, but sometimes he doesn't. They would stop following Jesus. People in my own family, as you know, that don't follow anymore. I am grieved. I weep at nighttime over the people that I love that don't follow Jesus anymore. We see an example of this in John 6:66. I explained those interesting verses last week. God doesn't make mistakes. Verse 66 of John 6 says this, from that time many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. Wednesday night, I sat right there where Sally's sitting in the back pew. No, actually, I was in the one above the front of it, I guess. Somewhere in there. This is after everybody left. I sit in the back after the seven people left. I really don't count, but the crowd was so small that night, it was hard not to count. And I looked at all the empty pews. Now, I was reminded that we are in the days of Laodicea. What do you mean, preacher? We're in the church age, I believe, when many people that call themselves Christians don't put Jesus first. They are lukewarm. There's apathy. There's a cloud of apathy. And Jesus is far from first place among those that call themselves Christians. Now, this church, I don't count, but I know that there are hundreds of people that call themselves members of this church. Many that no longer follow Jesus for whatever reason. So I read to you, if you want to turn there, as we bring this home, some very pointed scriptures for the day we live in. And if this is you, don't be sad and stop following. Don't be sad and stop following. Don't get mad at the preacher. Listen to Jesus. And, you know, Violet's birthday is today. And Mindy got home from work, I should say. And I knew I needed to get the girls a bath. Mindy washed her hair. My job was to go run the bath water. And you know, what do you got to do if the water's too cold or lukewarm? You turn the knob, right?
Yeah.
You turn more heat to it, right?
Yeah.
When our lives get lukewarm, and we start to fall away and fade away from Jesus, turn that Bible open, get in the Word and start doing what it says, and the heat will come back up. Amen?
Amen.
Here we go, Revelation 3, 14 and 15. I believe, I could be wrong because I'm not perfect, but I do believe that the Church of Jesus Christ, the born-again believers in the United States of America, I believe this is a picture of the church in America today. Revelation 3:14. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. By the way, that's Jesus. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. What about this one? Turn to Hebrews 10:38-39. It does not end well for the apostate. Hebrews 10:38-39. Now the just shall live by faith. But, here's that word, if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. Do we want to please God or not? But we are not of them who draw back. Are you hearing? Unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. I suggest to you that born-again believers, true followers of Jesus Christ, will be following Him till their last breath, and when He calls us out to meet Him in the air, they'll be believing and following Him.
Amen.
A man was sentenced to death. A man was sentenced to death for crimes he did not do. During his life, he was very popular at times. People even followed him in droves. But at his execution, most of his friends were not there for him. Only a few remained. Who was this?
Jesus
Christ. When Jesus returns, will He find true followers? Playing games isn't going to work. When the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth. At this time, I'm going to ask the deacon and the servants to come forward and move the table forward from me and remove the cloth. Bill will then ask to come grab a guitar and be ready to strum a little bit. We're getting ready to partake of the Lord's Supper. Jesus Christ, let me just share a verse with you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. God's mission was to seek and to save the lost, and he sought you if you're saved today. If you're here today and you've never been saved by Jesus Christ, he will save you now. Then the following begins. Amen. So, we come to this time. I was asked today, why are you dressed in black? Well, we're going to remember his death, but I have a white shirt on under here. It reminds me of a resurrection 3 days later. Amen?
Amen.
But we are to remember his death until he comes. Amen?
Amen.
We are to remember his death until he comes. Now, the Lord's Supper, who is it for? The Lord's Supper is for born-again believers. You don't have to be a Baptist, but you do have to be a born-again Christian. You don't have to be a member of this church, but you do have to be a born-again Christian. Well, how does a person become a born-again Christian? First, you need to know that in John chapter 3 and verse 3, the Bible teaches us that you must be born again to see the kingdom of God. It's a spiritual rebirth. We were dead in trespasses and sins, and then when we call out to Jesus, he saves us. So bow your head for a moment with me. The Bible says that we're all sinners. We say this every week because first a person needs to understand that they're lost before they can get saved. We have to understand that our sins, which we all are sinners, are an offense to a holy God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Every person in this room is a sinner. The Bible says in Romans 6:23 that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The Bible says in Romans 10:9-10 that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart a man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Do you believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins?
Amen.
Do you believe that he rose from the grave the third day?
Amen.
You should be able to remember a time in your life when you called on Jesus Christ to save you. The Bible says in Romans 10:13 that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord, they shall be saved. They shall be saved. If you know you're saved, with every eye closed, I won't even look up. I'm going to close my eyes. But for a testimony to Jesus Christ, with every eye closed, would you raise your hand if you've been saved by Jesus Christ? Then put it quickly down. If you're saved, the Lord's Supper is for you. If you're not sure if you're going to heaven, if you're not sure if you're saved, you can get saved right now. You can just, in your heart or whisper under your breath, you can call out to Jesus Christ, Lord, save me, I want to go to heaven. You can say, I'm not sure, I want to know Jesus, save me, I want to go to heaven. I know I'm a sinner, please save me, I want to be with you. I want to follow you. He will save you with that simple prayer. Then you need to tell somebody that happened. Now maybe you're here And you're saved, you've been washed in the blood, as we sing. Then now, as Bill strums a little bit, we're going to take a moment, because we have to be careful. As we partake of the Lord's Supper, we have to examine ourselves. We need to confess sins. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It is perfectly okay if you know that you're not saved or you know something's not right in your life to let the cup pass on by, let the bread pass on by. But if you confess your sins, be at peace to know that you are forgiven. You can partake of the Lord's Supper. We're going to go to the Lord now for just a few moments. Ask God to search your heart. And we are going to seek Him out and ask for His forgiveness. And here we go.